What's up, all my YouTube buddies? It's me, Jacob, with another vlog video. I'm here with my sister, hey. Jaimie, and we're about to see the upcoming... Ah, it's not upcoming. It's already out.
Ding dong!
Alright, so we're about to see the movie, The Kid Who Would Be King, a family-oriented kids movie from director Joe Cornish. I don't know much about this director, but I've heard he directed this cult film a couple years back called Attack the Block, which a lot of people I've heard say is a really awesome movie. All I know is he's good friends with Edgar Wright, so I have confidence.
That's a plus.
I have confidence that The Kid That Would Be King is going to be a fun movie, because I really like Edgar Wright from the stuff I've seen from him.
Yeah, Baby Driver, for example.
Baby Driver was my favorite movie of 2017. Yes, with or without Kevin Spacey, I still love Baby Driver.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, same here.
So The Kid Who Would Be King, I know it's this modern retelling of the King Arthur legend. And King Arthur is one of those stories that seems like Hollywood's done to death.
There's been at least three
different versions in the 21st century. We had the Jerry Bruckheimer produced mess with Clive Owen.
Oh man, I'm gonna miss out on that one.
That one was not good. And then we had 2017. We had Guy Ritchie direct King Arthur: Legend of the Sword, which bombed. That movie's a guilty pleasure of mine. I had a blast watching that film in theaters, and I was bummed that movie bombed, but yeah, you can't please everybody with a film as bonkers as King Arthur, that version of King Arthur especially. And I think The Kid That Would Be King had a disappointing opening weekend too, but the reviews for it have been really, really good, and a lot of people didn't really care for the trailers that much, but I saw the trailers I've seen of the film. I thought it looked fun,
truthfully.
Obviously, we're not judging a movie based on the trailers, because trailers could be misleading.
Yeah, but some just blow your mind away.
Yeah, it leaves you intrigued for what the movie could be. And, I'm hoping the movie satisfies. We're not expecting a masterpiece. Are you expecting a masterpiece?
No. Well, I decided to check this movie out.
Yeah, we're not expecting a masterpiece, but we hope to at least have a fun time at the movies. I do know Patrick Stewart is Merlin in this. I'm excited about that. I love Patrick Stewart. Hopefully he's going to be like so over the top. Walk-a-doo, 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 whack. Yeah. Wrong studio. While we're on this same subject, I'm honestly okay if Disney does a live action remake of Sword in the Stone. Do you think that would be a good idea?
Yeah, I think so. Because that's a trend Disney's doing now. We're making their classics.
I think if you want to make remakes that a lot of people are going to take seriously, because the ones they've currently been remaking, these films that, based on already hugely successful movies, like they've done Beauty and the Beast, and they've done Cinderella, and they're about to release Aladdin and The Lion King and Dumbo. Why don't you remake movies that weren't successful originally and try to make a better version of that film in live action? And The Sword and the Stone is one of those movies to me, it's one of those interesting failure-type films for Disney, and I'd like to see Disney do a second chance with that source material. That's kind of hard now, because there are so many studios that have done King Arthur movies. Like I said, we had the Guy Ritchie King Arthur, and now we got Kid Who Would Be King, but maybe one of these days. I'm hearing it's going to be one of the, I'm hearing that movie might be part of the Disney Plus streaming service when that comes out.
Yeah.
So we'll see. Hopefully we'll get one. But enough chit chat on King Arthur. We're about to go see The Kid Who Would Be King from director Joe Cornish. I think the studio is Fox.
Yeah.
Which is about to be merged with Disney, which I guess this is Disney's loose remake of Sword in the Stone.
Yeah, I'm saying modern society.
Okay, so we're about to see this film, and we'll let you know what we thought of the film when we get out of the theater, and we'll see you in a few hours. So we just finished watching The Kid Who Would Be King.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you have any thoughts on it?
Well, I've seen better stories based off the King Arthur legend.
Yeah.
But that wasn't too bad.
It's definitely an interesting take on the story. Definitely a more original take on the story. I think it does have a lot of the fantasy tropes based on the hero's journey type mythos, but it's done in a modern setting with kids. In a way, it kind of reminded me of Percy Jackson, but with the King Arthur legend. But better directed version of Percy Jackson, because...
Well, yeah. Percy Jackson, it was okay, but
You mean Percy Jackson.
I mean, yeah, Percy Jackson. Well, I liked it, but the sequel was kind of forgettable.
Yeah. You know a lot of fans of the book are going to pound you, because book fans hated that first Percy Jackson movie.
Okay, I forgot I said that.
No, that's fine. It's your opinion.
Yeah.
It's your opinion, Jaimie. But...
Yeah, well, I'm not a huge book reader, okay?
See, I read the Percy Jackson books. I thought the movie was fine. It wasn't a well-faithful adaptation, but as a standalone movie, I thought it was solid. Because you got Chris Columbus who directed that one. But back to The Kid Who Would Be King, this was Joe Cornish. Like I said in the intro, I haven't seen Attack the Block, his other movie, so I can't really say what his usual style is. But I like the vibe that he did with this film. Like I said, I know he and Edgar Wright are good buddies. And the movie did kind of feel like if Edgar Wright directed a kid's movie.
Yeah.
At times. So, yeah, you need to stick to being friends with Edgar Wright, because Edgar Wright's cool. It definitely had that quirky British humor touch.
Yeah, which, believe it or not, British humor is more complex than American humor.
I think they all know that, Jaimie. A lot of viewers love watching British movies.
And TV shows.
Brits are cool.
Yeah, they are.
And I think that was part of the fun of the movie, the quirkiness of the British cast and crew. I wasn't familiar with a lot of the actors that starred in this movie, but they all did a solid job, and they clearly had fun playing these characters.
Oh, yeah.
I liked that, you know, they acted like kids in this situation. Like, they quipped around a lot. There were a lot of pop culture references that a lot of modern kids do when they, you know, make jokes.
Yeah.
It definitely felt believable.
Mm-hmm.
The scene stealer, though, the guy they got playing Merlin, actually there's two actors that play Merlin. There's the younger teenager Merlin, and then you have the older version played by Patrick Stewart. And both are great. I think the younger Merlin is the scene stealer. He does this funny little move.
I want to do that.
Yeah. Probably gets the biggest laughs out of you.
Yeah, I noticed some people tried doing it in the theater.
Yeah, the theater we were at, we had a good little audience. There was this one little kid. He was so into this movie. And I think, let's hope that movie inspired him to be a better person or something, or a bigger fan of movies. Kind of like how we were as kids with the Harry Potter movies. It kind of inspired us into the world of filmmaking. Maybe not as filmmakers, but like the craft of it.
Yeah.
And the entertainment side of it. Just that Harry
Potter. And stress relief.
And the Harry Potter franchise is amazing. There's this one part of the movie, like, this cool action scene happens, and by the end of it, that kid was clapping. He was having so much fun.
Yeah, I think you guys mind blown at a young age.
Yeah, so that was really neat to see. So I guess in that regard, we do recommend this film for kids.
Yeah.
Even though there's some weird, creepy visuals in there, but
yeah,
they need a good scare once in a while.
Yeah, they sure do.
Yeah, because the show try to show them, you know, the world's not all bright and colorful.
Yeah, it's a shining light, pops.
Yeah, they gotta have some risks. You don't want to dumb them down.
Yeah, some scouts will have some great clouds.
Yeah. But I do think this was a fun little movie.
Yeah, it was fun.
It didn't wow me, but it was fun. I'll tell you one thing I didn't like in the film. I don't know what type of dope Rebecca Ferguson was on, but I couldn't really see her as the evil villain. She did this weird... Yeah, just... Every time I saw her, I'm like... Just stop, because...
Hey, Rebecca, you're in the wrong movie!
I mean, I love Rebecca Ferguson. She was one of the scene stealers in...
Yeah, Rogue Nation.
The recent Mission Impossible films, Rogue Nation and Fallout.
Fallout, yeah.
But here she's like... she's like this evil demon dragon thing, and she does this weird little voice, which I'm pretty sure some of it might have been... process and post, kind of like what they did with Kate Blanchett when she had that possessed voice.
Oh, yeah, but, no, I like that in Lord of the Rings.
And in Lord of the Rings, but that's different. Here,
yeah.
She does all the time and she's evil. And here's what she does the whole movie. I'm going to take over the world, a divide and conquer.
Okay, yeah, you're making it sound way more complicated than the actual person.
Oh, man, I just don't think it worked. I just didn't see her as a villain. And every time I saw her, like, I get where the character was coming from. I'll give her that. I kind of like that the movie relied on real world problems to bring her in, like they talk about like the world being a hateful place. But yeah, I just didn't really buy Rebecca Ferguson in that villain role.
Couldn't the universe buy a more sinister or something?
I would have been okay if they had Kate Blanchett.
Yeah.
especially since she just recently played Hela in Thor Ragnarok.
Nothing her seriously after that. Of course, she's still a good actress.
Of course, yeah, Thor Ragnarok, she was over the top and evil. But we don't want to typecast her either. So, alright. I guess wrapping this up.
I would give this 3.5 out of 5.
3.5?
Yeah.
Okay. Pretty solid rating. I think I'm going to give it a 4 because... I think for its target audience, the kids, they're going to love this movie. It's a shame the movie's not doing well because I think, you know, younger kids will see the film, get something out of it. Might make them better people because it kind of teaches them, you know, the fundamental messages of, you know, being good.
Yeah.
Not all of the movie works. Like I said, I didn't really care for the villain that much. But I definitely enjoyed its uniqueness. The humor was a lot of fun. The cast was great. I definitely enjoyed its unique visual style. So like I said, I'm going to give it a 4 out of 5. On the 100-point scale, I'm going to give it a 73.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, 73. I think it's a solid rating. So I think it's a similar rating I gave Wrinkle in Time. I think A Wrinkle in Time and The Kid Who Would Be King have similar intentions. Although a lot more people like Kid Who Would Be King, though. I still like A Wrinkle in Time. Don't judge me.
Yeah, don't judge me either.
All right, so that was our vlog trip video for The Kid Who Would Be King. Let us know down in the comments below what you thought of this movie. If you saw it, did you love it? Did you hate it? Please be civil in the comments section, because this movie teaches you to be good people. So respect your opinions.
Yeah. Respect it.
Or respect your opinions and others' opinions. All right, so we both have accounts on Letterboxd, and I guess we'll leave links in the description below if you want to see some of the stuff we do on that website. We, you know, do different reviews of stuff in type format. A lot of it, movies we, you know, don't have time to do on like YouTube and stuff. I think Jaimie's is, your reviews are a lot more jokier, I've noticed, than mine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because you tend to see things more of an entertainment eye. But.
Yeah, but it's just me.
Yeah, it's just Jaimie. Alright, so if you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up.
Sorry, delayed. Okay.
Thumbs up.
Thumbs up.
We're keeping that in. All right. After you give it a thumbs up, click the subscribe button to see more content of mine, and click the little bell next to it to be notified of future videos. Definitely have some more vlog videos coming for you soon. If you saw a previous video, you know some of the upcoming planned movie vlogs I'd love to do in February. Hopefully Jaimie will join me in these, because you're kind of excited about some of these. Lego Movie 2.
Yep.
Alita Battle Angel.
Oh, yeah.
How to Train Your Dragon, The Hidden World.
Oh, yeah, that's just, I mean, yeah. How to Train Your Dragon, that's actually my highly anticipated anime movie for this year, by the way.
Yeah, it looks really good. I'm hearing great early buzz about that movie already. I think some are comparing it to like the best of Pixar.
That's
an amazing sign.
Oh yeah, because I do like DreamWorks, but it's no Disney.
Yeah, I don't think they ever will be, but when they make great stuff, they need all the credit they can get.
Yeah.
All right, so definitely look forward to upcoming vlog videos. Hope you have an amazing day, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye. Bye.